Lord have mercy. We got an opportunity to praise the Lord one more day. Yes. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. In the midst of all that we've been going through, in the midst of all this trials and struggles we got going on, we got one more day to bless His holy name. Lord have mercy.
Amen.
Come on up, bro.
Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He's worthy.
Yes.
He's worthy.
Yes.
One of the most beautiful things we can describe about our God and Father is one thing. I woke up this morning, and I encourage everybody, and the earth have no excuse to say it and lift it up. Holy.
Yes.
Holy.
Yes.
Holy.
Yes.
Holy.
Yes.
The angels cry, holy. Holy. If there could ever be a prayer,
yes, Lord.
Whether it be morning, noon, evening, in the watches of the night, or even if you're traveling, you can just drive down the road and say, God, you are holy.
Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, yes,
you are holy.
Uh-huh.
There is no one like you. No. Why? Because you are
holy.
Holy.
Thank you,
Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Glory to God. The pastor of this house, neighbors, visiting family and friends, brothers and sisters, I also come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay? I don't come to you in the name of Allah.
Amen.
Who is alive.
Ah.
I don't come to you in the name of Buddha.
Come on. Come on.
Confucius.
All right.
Amen.
But I come in the name, you come in the name, we've gathered together in the name of the name of the one who saved us from our sins. Amen. Jesus Christ. And that name that is in you, in me, in us, is eternal. Eternal. I just want to give honor to also my good friend Pastor Matt and others who have allowed me to share my testimony, my overcoming story of overcoming grief.
Amen.
I lost my wife last year in 2021 with a diagnosis of COVID pneumonia.
Mm-hmm.
I also was in a hospital as well with COVID pneumonia. Mm-hmm. I'm here to let you know it could have been the both of us.
Mm-hmm.
That's how serious it was when I was in the hospital at Chesapeake General. But I've learned something, brothers and sisters, that in spite of all that we may experience in life, and you may have experienced recently, in the event of a loss of a friend or a loved one, or a pet, how many of you know that grief just doesn't come even when we just lose someone dear and close to us?
That's right.
People experience grief because they've lost a job. They've lost their family dog. You'll be amazed at the connection of people who grieve because their German Shepherd or their Rottweiler or their poodle passed away because their pet was a part of the family. And then there are issues like the pandemic. People are still grieving the pandemic. Promotion. They expected to get a promotion and still never it happened. There are things even in church. How many of you know that people, or you may have known, or you have experienced, people grieve because of church hurt.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Even pastors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Even prophets.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing I've learned through this grief is that I've learned something so powerful, even in my walk and even in my maturity in the midst of this process, and losing my dear wife and others. It's understanding this. We're here to let you know that you're not alone. You're never alone. God is going to be Emmanuel, not just around Christmas time. But Jesus said, I will be with you how long? Always. To the ends of the earth. So my brothers and my sisters, when grief through his eyes came about, I received a call from the coach and visionary, who is the author, Sister Deborah Fry. I'm here to let you know and just encourage you. I'm not here to sell. I'm here to bless.
Amen.
Okay? I'm here to sow in the kingdom because it's all about the kingdom.
Yes.
It's got to be all about the kingdom.
Amen.
Okay?
Right.
Jesus said, and this gospel shall be preached to the nations around the world, the gospel of the kingdom, and then the end shall come.
Right.
So So we have a mission. I have a mission with the Lord has put in my heart, along with other 13 co-authors who have collaborated together through this men's anthology, Grief Through His Eyes, Seeing Grief from His Point of View. Now, it is a men's anthology, but women have been blessed in buying this thing off the shelf like crazy, because it's been a true inspiration to their lives, and to their homes, and to their families, and even to the church. I'm hearing people that are even using this as group sessions to help them overcome and become champions of over grief. I share that with you because at one point in a time in our lives, we are going to go experience grief one way or another. Okay? Another way for grief to describe grief is just nothing more than just a weight. A weight of things that a lot of times we don't want to happen, whether it be sudden or unexpectedly. Okay? One of the things I've learned according to Psalms 126, verse 5, and I outline this in my chapter, is those who sow in tears. Those who sow in tears. How many of you cry? Okay, those who sow in tears shall reap a, watch this, harvest of joy. Have you ever drove by a cornfield and just seen a harvest of corn, a harvest of beans, a harvest of cotton? Well, I'm here to let you know that even in the midst of your difficulties, your trying times, and the test of times, God is able to take some of the most difficult things we may experience in our lives and work it out for his good. Amen? Oh, yes, he do. I don't know nobody else who can do that. Who can take our mess, our faults, our mistakes, our hurt, our emotional traumas, our grief, and work it out for his good and for our Lord, for the God, for the glory of God.
Amen.
And I shared it with this, along with the book that the Lord has blessed me to be a co-author with. I am so humbly honored to be one of the co-authors and to share my story, not to just make people continue to walk through life with their head down, okay? Because God has given us exceeding precious promises, amen?
Amen.
And he desires to do the best in our lives through not only just the tools that you have as ministers of a new covenant, but also through this wonderful anthology. So only $20. I mailed out a couple of copies this week, you know, to my good friends and those who are in, who have really been truly blessed. And for men, this is, I would have to say this, this is the first ever men's anthology where men is dealing with grief. Men. Now, ladies, you got a lot of stories out there. You guys got a lot of testimonies and how-tos and all that stuff. But when it comes to men opening up and dealing with grief, it's a totally different story. Because how many of you know it takes for men to break the ice, it really takes the men to, you know, to grab them at the horns of and bring them to the altar and say, I need help.
Amen.
This here is a tool in a toolbox, in your toolbox, men and women, that will help men understand that they're not alone and that they too can be champions. That God created us in his image. Champions over grief in times of pride. Times of trouble, times of struggles and distress, and helping us know that in the last days, we too can be, as what Paul said, more than conquerors through Christ Jesus, who loved us and everything. So I'll be available if you desire to purchase a copy. It's only $20, okay? And the blessing of it is, if you know those who are also, and this is the holiday season, and what an opportune time to bless men and women. You know, not just with a book, but books.
Yeah.
Okay, you'll be amazed. I mailed out at one point to a CEO, just a quick story, and I'll be done. I mailed out 20 copies, autographed copies, to Houston, Texas.
Amen.
Okay? And the beautiful thing, I was so blessed. And as a result, she also sowed into my life because of what she heard from me and my story. So that's my testimony, and I thank you, and God bless.
Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. So we don't know where people are going through or what people have been through. You know, so I know that his testimony in that book will bless those of us who have been going through griefs and any kind of traumas in our lives. So thank you.
Praise the Lord. Pastor.
Amen.
If you have your swords with you, could you turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 4? Book of Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 1 through 4. If you could, you stand with me for the reading of the word. And it reads as thus: If you will return, O Israel, return to me, declares the Lord. If you put your detestable idols out of my sight and no longer go astray, and if in a truthful, a trustful, just and righteous way you swear, as surely as the Lord lives, then the nations will be blessed by him. And in him they will glory. This is what the Lord says to the men of Judah and to Jerusalem. Break your unplowed ground, break up your unplowed ground, and do not sow among thorns. Verse 4 says, circumcise yourselves to the Lord, circumcise your hearts, you men of Judah and people of Jerusalem, or my wrath will break out and burn like fire because of the evil you have done. Burn with no one to quench it. Solutions. The church. What is the problems and the answers to the church? Matthew chapter 18. Starting in verse 15. Hallelujah. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 18, starting at verse 15. Listen to what Jesus says. If your brother sins against you, go and show him his fault. Just between the two of you, if he listens to you, you have won your brother over.
Yes.
But if he will not listen, take one or two other along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refused to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refused to listen even to the church, treat him as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Verse 18 says, I tell you the truth. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen.
Praise God from the church.
Yes.
Teaching us some solutions about the church.
Yeah.
failure, God, you have every victory.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Come on, Jesus.
No.
Thank you, Jesus.
You all stand to your feet at this time. Let us bow. Father God, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for your people, Lord.
Yes,
Lord, give back to them some 30, some 40, some 50, some 100 fold back to their household.
Yes, Lord.
Where there be meat in their refrigerators, Lord, and canned goods in their cabinets.
Yes, God.
God, we thank you. We praise your name. Use this offering, Lord, as only you can.
Yes.
Multiply, God, where we will have more than enough. God, we thank you. And we praise your name. Or it's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. All things come of thee.
All things come of thee, O Lord. And of thine own as we give of thee. Praise the Lord. I'd like to just shout out to my 50-year-old friend back there in the corner trying to be incognito. Out to Robson. Praise God for you. Thank you for being here. The Lord is very confused and knee-high to a grasshopper.
All right.
Hey, praise the Lord. Good to see you, brother. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, praise the Lord. I'm going to go ahead and start. I know we have a selection, but I'm going to go ahead and start because I'm ready to hear a word. Are y'all ready for some word?
Yeah.
Yeah. And, thank you, guys, everybody here. If you could. No, I can't fit over there. Can you fit over there?
It's all right. Just call them out. Just call them out. It's better just to spray it out. Yeah.
Okay.
It's good.
Everybody, okay. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, this is the vision program once again, and it's something I've been doing for years. It's giving people an opportunity that not otherwise would have the opportunity to preach at their churches or anywhere they are. So I give people an opportunity to come in, whereas you guys, I know you all are offices in your churches and you get a chance to speak, but I just thank God for this assembly today of men and women of God who give us the word. Amen. I know that God is going to use you all mightily. I was saying earlier that God will use you through your struggles and your pains. Amen. Amen. So praise the Lord. And I also told one of the ministers, I say, look at the Bible of the program, and it says, order subject to change. So I know y'all looking at it like, oh, this the order. But the order is subject to change. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So, with that being said, hallelujah, glory to God. So you all know that you have, I'm going to, it says 7 minutes, but I'm going to give y'all 10. Okay. Is that all right?
All right.
Is that all right?
All right.
Amen. So I'm going to give you 10 minutes.
Amen.
And y'all don't want to embarrass your pastors. So this is what you call being decent in an order and prepared. Amen. 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 And I know you can do it in 10 minutes.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. If we as a church want to change, the key is to be in the world, but not of the world. Transform our thinking and be kingdom minded, not earthly minded. And with that being said, Minister E. Pritchett from St. Paul Christian Fellowship. Hallelujah. We're going to hand up the prayer.
How you walking?
How you walking?
And walk in love as Christ. offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savior.
All right. Yeah.
Jesus. Jesus. He said, be followers. Thank you, Heavenly Father. You see, being followers, the Lord demands of us to sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Sacrifice. Sacrifice hurts.
Yes.
Sacrifice hurts.
Yes.
Love demands sacrifice.
Yes.
Requiring us to love whether it's deserved or not.
Yeah.
Jesus. Thankfully, our great God provided us with the ultimate example of love.
Mm-hmm.
He offered his one and only son to die for us while we still were sinners. Amen?
Amen.
Are we willing to walk? Here we go. Walk in the way of love for our spouse. In our leadership,
come on.
Are we demonstrating love? Come on.
All right.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Yes.
Be encouraged knowing the love you give to each other is an act of worship and obedience to God.
All right.
Your kind and uplifting words
All right.
reflect
yes.
his mercy to you.
Yes.
Your generosity flows from the blessing of his hands.
Yes.
Your humility and patience. Somebody say
patience.
Are an echo of our servant.
Yes.
Heart of Christ, when you lay down your lives for another, sacrificing, you're surrendering more completely to the Lord. It's not about you, it's about him, amen?
Yes.
We are nothing without him.
Yes.
I come here today for an assignment, amen?
Yes.
It's not about me, it's about him.
Amen.
Now let the marriages, number four, be a fragrant offering to you. Let the leadership be a fragrant offering to the body.
Yes.
You see, the enemy says when you're having struggles in your marriage, in your relationship, Holy Spirit, help me. The world says, cut it off and run. Pursuing your own happiness. The Lord says, stay and fight. 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 Jesus, Jesus. I know about fighting. I was once married for 20 years. Talk about fights.
Yes.
Jesus, get ready to get married again, hallelujah, because I lost the spouse of 20 years. God be the glory, say hope.
Hope.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen.
You see, he holds everything that you need. That's the key, Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus, to make it through. The key to leadership is king. It's about how you walk. How you walking? Jesus, in the church, when you're told what to do, how you walking when you have constructive criticism coming your way and correction with positive reinforcement to be found? How you walking? These are the keys to leadership. It's how you walking and what are you listening to, because the word of God says, my sheep hear my voice. Come on, John chapter 10, 27 through 28, the key, knowing his voice. Jesus, my sheep, he said, hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me.
Yeah.
Verse 28, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish.
Amen.
We shall never perish.
Amen.
Neither shall any man put them out of my hand.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, this is your reasonable service.
Amen.
Jesus, Jesus, people don't always want to be told what they're doing wrong. They already know what they're doing wrong. They need to be encouraged when they're doing right. Give them the hope for why it is you believe in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As we stand in the gap as leadership for them who desperately and secretly are holding on with their last breath, with their last straw, when they don't know if they can make it because they're dealing with grief, for an example. Help us, Lord. And love the hell out of them, amen? Jesus, I heard the Holy Spirit say, you see, I'm only trying to burn those things that would weaken your battle. I'm in that fiery furnace. I heard Revelation chapter 2, verse 10 says, do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Woo! But be faithful. Even to the point of death.
Hey.
And I will give you life as your victor's crown.
Yes.
Tell your neighbor, you're in your ninth day.
Yes.
You're coming out of this. You're in the ninth day. Hold on.
Hold on.
Yes. Hold on.
Hold on.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus. The leadership key is to intercede, to pray, to fast, to wait patiently.
Uh-huh.
Let's continue to live in a way that illuminates Christ in our lives.
Yes.
Jesus, we're not supposed to look like them of the world. We're supposed to be set aside.
All right.
Jesus, Jesus, let's stay humble. things off you that was weaken your value while you in the fire. Ephesians chapter 5, 1 through 7. I want you to write that down and study it when you get home. Ephesians 1, verse 14 says, wake up! Do not be deceived, for the word says, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He says, wake up, Jesus. Even the very elect will be deceived.
All right.
Wake up! Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. Uh-oh! Here we go! Here we go! Jesus, then it says, then ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And I order to know what the will of the Lord is. In order to know what the will of the Lord is, we must study and comprehend. Amen?
Amen.
And this is the last key. I'm going to land this plane right now. I want you to saturate this in your heart because God knows. Amen? God knows. Boom. Psalms 126 and 1. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. When the Lord brought back the captives to Zion, we were like men who dream. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. And then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them.
Yes.
The Lord has done great things for us.
Yes.
And we are filled with joy.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The key, he will not put more on you than you can bear.
Amen.
Let's key in on these promises and these truths in the scriptures and be effective leaders for the body of Christ. I'm out. I love you.
Yes. Amen.
Effective leadership.
Yes.
Praise God from Zion.
Amen.
You have to follow the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yes.
That's the key.
Amen.
All right. Amen. When things going wrong, when you get corrected, can you still follow Him?
Yeah.
God Almighty.
God Almighty.
Amen.
Jesus. Give her a hand clap of praise. Woo. One more time. Honor. All right. Now, God, God, God. Thank you, Lord. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their faults. Just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two along with you so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen to the church, treat them as a pagan or a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth, you are bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Matthew chapter 18, verse 15 through 18. If the church want the problems solved, point out the problems and bind them on earth that they may be loosed in heaven.
Amen.
And we're going to get ready to hear this young lady from St. Paul Christian Fellowship, Minister Abria Davis, all the way from
Well, good evening, everybody. Again, my name is Abria Davis, and today I'm coming before you the topic solved.
All right.
How can we solve the church problem? So I'm just going ahead and jump right on in, get to the meat and potatoes. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So how can we solve the church problems? Well, it's very simple. It's a simple answer. It all starts with a change of attitude towards God.
Right.
A change of attitude towards God. See, conviction is good for the believer.
Right.
Conviction is good. And I know some of you may be thinking, well, how is conviction a good thing? Well, when God wants to bring an awareness to you about something that he wants to help change for the better, when he wants to act out of love yet again to help you accomplish that goal you have for yourself, he has to bring an awareness to you. He's not there to beat you up, to make you feel like you just can't amount to nothing. It's another opportunity to get it right by him. He's trying to save you before you get yourself over into a situation you don't need to be in. See, conviction is a good thing when he's tugging on that heartstring. You know that feeling when he's saying, you know, you need to apologize. But we turn our head and, I'm not doing that. See, that's him just displaying his love and his love to us. And see, conviction, it results in repentance. Conviction results in cleansing. Conviction results in freedom. Amen?
Amen.
But it takes you to have a change of attitude towards God.
Amen.
See, all a change of attitude towards God is being obedient to his word.
Yes.
Amen. Choosing to make him your first choice, your first priority.
Right.
Not your man, not your job, not your kids, your career, not whatever those goals you're trying to accomplish, but him. That's you having a change of attitude towards God. Amen. See, the book of Hebrews, chapter 3, verse 15 reads, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. It's like today, not tomorrow, not next month, but today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. And then it goes on to say, as you did in the rebellion, speaking of those Israelites that Moses led out of Egypt. See, they were still complaining, still going against the voice of God, even after they were free. But the word says, do not harden your hearts. See, don't be disobedient to what God's telling you, that conviction. Because when you are disobedient, now you just operating in the flesh, doing and saying whatever it is that you want to do and say. Right? No filter, just clapping back. Right? Right, do whatever the flesh wants to do, right? So you done showed up to the church, to the body of Christ, with all this stuff, because we're all wrestling with something every day. So you done showed up to the body of Christ, and by the way, we wrestle with three things. Three things we wrestle with: our flesh, this world system, and the enemy, the adversary, Satan. So you done showed up, not listening, taking heed to that conviction, and now you in the church just saying and doing whatever you want to do. Then Brother Daniel over here, he done walked up in the church with all his stuff, not listening, be obedient, taking conviction. And so now it's just no God in the midst. There's no solution being made. There's no problems being solved because God was not welcome. He's not in the atmosphere. But I've stopped by to tell you, change of attitude towards God and repenting with a sincere heart. It allows us to be redeemed through Christ Jesus by God's grace. Amen. Amen. Come with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. The book of Ephesians, chapter 2. And I'm going to start at verse 5. Or excuse me, verse 4. And it reads, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. See, Jesus did not have to take on our sin. He was born sinless, but he carried our sin. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sin. Amen? That's grace. That is love. So once you've obeyed that conviction, once you've repented and been justified by faith, then we receive these gifts from God, the fruit of the Spirit. See, we inherit these gifts because we are now part of God's family. We are working with him in the kingdom. And although we know that we have these gifts, we still have an opportunity to humble ourselves daily and ask turns. He directs our tongue on what to say and how to say it. Then he exposes us even more on our unique gifts and talents, because we're all blessed with something, each and one and every one of us. We can all bring something to the table. So he brings us together so we can work together, solve problems, provide solutions, but we're portraying it in God's love. Amen. So as I come to my close, I'll leave you with this. 1 Corinthians 16:14. Do everything in love. Love is what we need the most. Amen.
Give her a hand clap. Okay. My God. No way. We need the Holy Spirit. We say, send the Holy Spirit to show us all things. When you need some solving, problem solving, the Holy Spirit will show you what you need to do. God Almighty. If you're not led by the Holy Spirit, then you ain't solving nothing. You don't lean on to your own understanding. Lord, can we give her a hand clap of praise? The Lord used her. Oh my God.
Amen.
Jesus.
If we as the church want results, preach the truth in love in and out of season.
Yes, God.
2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 through 5.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And with that being said, all the way from Chesapeake, Virginia, by way of Firm Foundation, World of Two Ministry, my student, First Lady, Yvette Brion.
Get a little nervous, a little butterfly. And I know that's the humility, amen, being humble. Thank God have his way, amen. Amen. I thank God for being here, amen. This is our home away from home, praise God.
Amen.
And my word, as you know, is results.
Amen.
Results, amen, of the church.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. I'm going to do like Minister Bria, get to the meat of the table. Amen. And I will pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, oh God. Thank you for another day in the land of the living, oh God. We thank you that you make all things possible. We can't do anything without you, oh God. Oh God, bless the speakers that were before me and the ones that are to come, oh God. And what receive it, to you be the honor and the glory.
Yes.
We give you thanks and praise, oh God. Thank you for always making things possible, oh God. You are the, you do the impossible, oh God. When man say no, you say yes.
Yes.
And we thank you in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 If I have a topic, my topic would be for the sake of the gospel. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. My word is resolved. So that was about 2 minutes on my team, right? Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 In this world today, we know that there is an urgency. Amen. For the state of the church. Amen.
Yes.
You got, it's an emergency. Amen. To get the church back into its proper place. Amen.
Amen.
The way God intended it. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. So we as believers need to come back to our first love.
Yes.
When we first believe. Amen.
Yes.
And it starts with self-examination.
Yes.
Amen. We have to start with us. Amen. Yes. Praise God. My text is Jeremiah 21:14. And it says, I replenish you according to the results of your deeds, declares the Lord, and I will kindle a fire in this forest that it may devour all its fire. And that's the NASB. Amen. So here in Jeremiah, King Zedekiah sent word to Jeremiah by Pashar and Zephaniah. on his behalf to Nebuchadnezzar,
yes,
king of Babylon, to inquire of the Lord to perform wonders for us like he did in past times, mm-hmm, so that Babylon would withdraw from them. But the Lord's prophet Jeremiah said, tell King Zedekiah, this is what the Lord says. Says, I am about to turn against you the weapons of war that are in your hands, which you are using to fight King of Babylon, who are outside the walls besieging you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And this is just saying in past historical acts, past historical acts do not guarantee new deliverance from God. Amen?
Amen.
He exercises his freedom to bring a wrath and judgment on a people who depends on history and tradition rather than faith and obedience. Amen? So God is not a genie. Amen? He's not Buddha who rub his belly and get a wish. He's not a genie in a bottle. Hallelujah. Amen? Amen. So in Jeremiah, the people of Jeremiah in that time, they rejected God. And they rejected the Torah. Amen? Amen. So the only hope left for them is to wholeheartedly return to the Lord. Let's fast forward to now. People are rejecting the body of Christ, the word of God every day. People reject Jesus. They don't believe the Bible is the Bible. They said the Bible is words of fiction and fairy tale because man wrote it, but who else was going to write it? Amen? Man wrote it. Amen? Praise God. The word of God is the word of God. Amen? And so that starts with self-examination. Amen. We got to make sure that we're lining up to what God has for us. Amen. Making sure that this temple is a godly temple. Amen. That we are obedient. Amen. Amen. We got to be careful of what we see with the eyes, hear with the ears, speak out the mouth, do with the hands. Praise God. Amen. Self-examination. Amen. Amen. Check your attitude towards everybody. Amen. Your loved ones, your friends. Check your attitude. Amen. Amen. Stop allowing every and anything into your temple. Praise God. All this foolishness is going on in the world. Like she said, we got to be in the world, but not us. Amen. Amen. And God is looking at us. We can't point the finger at anybody else. Amen. This is self-examination. Don't look to the left or the right. Look straight in the mirror at yourself. And work on you. Praise God. So we can get the body of Christ back to where it's supposed to be. We are out of order. We need to get in order.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. So allowing all these things to come in, amen, we have competition in the body of Christ. We have jealousy in the body of Christ. Amen. Always want to be seen. Look at me, look at me. Amen. Amen. Everybody wants to be seen. Amen. Amen. God is not welcome in the house of God anymore. Look at me, look at me. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And then when you have all of those things, you know, as praise and worship, we used to have praise and worship. Praise and worship is no longer praise and worship. Praise and worship is showtime at the Apollo. Entertainment time. Amen. Hallelujah. Everybody want to be seen. I can say that in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the result of all the foolishness, all the isms and schisms that we allow into the church and also into this church. The church is in a state of disaster. The church is in a state of urgency. To come back to the first love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Because you know, you need to check yourself. If you are a dysfunctional person and a mess individually, you're going to be dysfunctional and a mess collectively. Amen. And it's destroying the church. Amen. Check yourself. Praise God. Amen. Amen. So we have to be very careful about the things that we allow in our church. Amen. Because church no longer to people is the backbone of the community. I hear people say it's a social club. Social gathering. Any and everything goes. Amen. And people allow all that stuff in the church, and just because it happens in the church, that don't mean it's from God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Flesh is taking over. Amen. Amen. So we got to be careful again. We can change the results of the church. Be careful. Amen. Amen. And how do we know the church is out of order and church is no longer a priority? Go past some of these stores on Sunday. Walmart and Ross and Sam's. The parking lots are packed.
Yes.
But you ride past the church on Sunday. You're a small church. You might have got bad calls.
Yes.
It's no longer a priority.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. But I believe we need to go back like the church of old. Praise God. I don't have to pay. People say, oh, times have changed. But the word of God is still the word of God.
Yes.
I'm crazy enough to believe that faithfulness, obedience, and holiness is still a requirement.
Yes.
Holiness is still a requirement. Praise God.
Amen.
as believers, my God, that's a must-have.
Yes.
Obedience, faith, and wholeness is a must-have.
Yes.
You know how they say Oprah got her must-have things every month? But this is for the believers.
Yes.
We must have holiness.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
To get the church back in order.
Yes.
That God will be pleased. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. So how do we change the results of the church? I'm going on, I'm not about to land this plane. Amen. How do we change the results of the church? And I'm glad you asked. I am. I'm really glad you asked. Amen. My other text is Titus. Titus 2 and 10. Hallelujah. It says, the apostle said that living like Christ is crucial because it can make the gospel attractive. Praise God. Amen. So we were attracted some kind of way to be over here. Praise God. So we got to be careful because we're being watched to make the gospel attractive. Amen. And that's just like a relationship. You see someone of the opposite sex, you may be attracted to. And what do you do about that? You want to get to know them.
Yes.
You want to spend time with them.
Uh-huh.
Amen. You want to build a relationship with them.
Yes.
Amen. So that's what we have to do. Amen. And I remember my late uncle, Pastor Artis Burks. Oh my God. He used to say this all the time. He loved him and said, I know a man.
Mm.
Hallelujah. That sits closer than a brother.
Yes.
Amen.
Lord.
A man. Hallelujah. Who is this man?
Yes.
He is Adam's redeemer.
Yes.
Huh? He is Noah's ark. He's Moses' bush on fire.
Yes.
He's Ezekiel's wheel in the middle of the wheel.
Yes.
He is Solomon's crystal.
Yes.
Amen. He is Samson's power.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He is the rock in the river land. Hallelujah.
Yes.
He is the bright and the morning star.
Yes.
He is the lily of the valley. Hallelujah.
Yes.
He's Mary's baby boy. Hallelujah. He's James and Jude's former brother. Hallelujah.
Yes.
He is the act of coming of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Huh? He is my all in all.
Yes.
Church, hallelujah, is to have an intentional, authentic relationship with the source. We got to have a relationship with the source. Praise God. We got to move beyond discipleship and have a relationship with the source. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because he is not a way, he is the way. And Jesus is his name.
Hey! My God! To get results, oh God, you got to come to the Father. Woo, girl! My God! She told me, she said, I don't want you to see what I'm doing. I'm going to get him out of the room. Lord have mercy. She said she was in a plane. She wasn't in no plane. She was in a spaceship.
Yeah.
Oh, she gonna land a plane. Get a little hand clap of praise for me.
Kim Gardner
Boone. Hallelujah.
Hide me behind thy cross, oh God. Let them hear all the words that you have for them and none of mine. In Jesus' name I just pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I'm going to tell you about the story. Anybody ever been on the highway and gotten down the road and heard something go boom? And it goes boom, 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 boom. Boom. And you realize that you have gotten a flat tire. And so you had to call the AAA or somebody to come get you off the road. And you didn't want to leave your car there. So you asked them if they could do something to your tire so you can get your car off the road. Sometimes they may change and put on one of those donut tires.
Yeah.
Sometimes they might put a quick fix in your tire, something called a fix-a-flat. And they will pump your tire up and put a fix-a-flat in your tire to get you to from one point to the other. It is called a quick fix. A quick fix in your tire, just so you can get from point A to point B. Also, sometimes when my husband is a mechanic, so every time I speak, I'm always referring to automobile. So, have I had your car run hot on you?
Yeah.
Anybody been in the midsummer time and it's hot outside and you riding really cool down the highway, feeling good with your air conditioning on, and all of a sudden you hear something go psst. You realize that either your radiator or something has sprung a leak and stuff is running all in the floor of your car, and you call to get it fixed, and they put something in it called a sealant.
Yeah.
A sealant, what it does is it just seals the leak until you can get it fixed. This is called a quick fix. Come on, everybody with me. Everybody know what I'm talking about. Okay, all right now. So here, I am going to talk to you about the solution of the church. Amen. Amen. We're all here talking about what we need to do to help the church out, right? Amen. So I'm just going to be very literal with you. I'm a literal person. I talk about real issues. I talk about real things. Yeah. I don't jump around and do anything extra. I just tell you what it is. Yeah. All right, so I'm talking about some literal issues. We talk about some problems in the church. Yeah. Amen? Amen? And we want to do some things to fix the church. Yeah. But the church has many issues. Yeah. And we know that, first of all, the church should be the example. Uh-huh. Somebody, uh-huh. We first must be the example. Yeah. And then here in our text, it says there comes a time that judgment must begin at the household of faith. Come on, somebody. Yes. We're the ones that people on the outside are looking at. Yes. We're the ones that they're supposed to be calling to when trouble comes. Yes. When the problem strikes, they're looking to the church to help them solve their problem. Yes. But here we have a problem in the church. Yes. We have the church trying to figure out how they're going to solve some problems. Let's see if some of the quick fixes that the church used to try to solve some problems here. I just want you to know, here's an example, holding events. Now, don't get me wrong, guys. Don't put me in a box here. I'm trying to get outside this box here to let you understand that these are some things that the church do to try to fix problems. Now, if your church don't have a problem, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the majority of churches that are using these things to fix problems, okay? Yeah, holding events such as concerts and dinner sales and bake sales, ushers and trustees and missionaries and pastors' anniversaries and all kinds of things that they're doing trying to fix a problem that they have yet to be touched, which we all have already heard about already today. The problem is the issues with the heart. The problem is the issues with love. The problem is issues of giving strength to other people. The problem is issues with giving it behind. I'm talking about the fruit of the Spirit. We don't have it. So we want to hold these types of events so that we can figure out what the problem is. Hallelujah. All you're doing is piling on more problems. You want to sell dinner, but you can't stand beside the person who's selling dinner with you. Amen. You want to hold it.
Collect and pass that collection plate around.
They're quick fixes. Yeah. Come on.
Yes, Lord.
Because that's not what it's about.
Yeah.
It's about the heart.
Yes.
Right? It's been preached already.
All right.
It's not the heart of man. It's about saving souls. It's about building God's kingdom.
Yes.
When we get our heart right, we can get the church right.
Yes.
And when we now realize that we are the church.
Yeah.
We the people are the church.
Yeah.
This is the kingdom of God sitting in the building.
Yes.
These are walls.
Yes.
These are buildings.
That's, right.
That's not the church. We're supposed to be able to preach the word. Where we go, we're all called to give an account about that. We're all called to be able to tell everybody what we're doing. We're all called. It's not that I am Reverend So-and-so. I am Minister So-and-so. And that's Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. The Lord God says, no man comes into the Father except through him. No man.
Yeah.
And our job is to make sure that every person that comes through the door knows who he is.
Yeah.
On, that's what the church is supposed to do.
Yeah. That's right.
We're supposed to tell everybody about the love of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Who he is.
Yeah.
The Son of the Father, the Almighty God in heaven. We're supposed to tell them that Jesus came and he died on a cross for them and saved them from their sins.
Yeah.
All they got to do is believe and confess with their mouth. We don't confess anymore.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to confess Jesus anymore.
Jesus.
Nobody wants to say, I repent of my sins anymore. Nobody wants to speak it out of their mouth because the word says confess with your mouth and believe in your heart.
And you're saved. Jesus.
Or they don't see it.
Uh-huh.
The word tells us that.
Come on.
We are all trying to get to heaven.
Yes.
And there's only one way to heaven.
All right.
And that's through Jesus Christ.
Yes.
He's the only
fix. He's the fix.
He is the fix.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
He is the fix
that
fixes the church.
Right.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Hey, Abria, I got some important gift for all y'all. Y'all
be. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. I get you some sweet. Praise the Lord. My God, give her a hand clap of praise. I tell you, all your grand programs and all your little stuff that you do, if Jesus ain't in it and you ain't trying to save souls, it ain't nothing but a quick fix. It don't mean we know it.
Amen.
All you want to do is be seen. Live. Steady going to heaven.
That's right.
Yes, Lord.
You got a grand program, though. You made a lot of money.
Well,
everybody saw you.
Yeah.
Got a chance to tell people who you were.
My God.
Jesus ain't in it.
Oh,
it ain't number of quick. My God. Ooh, me. Well, I knew it. God is awesome. God.
Yes, he is.
Ooh, he's awesome. God, what a mighty God.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Yes,
man.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God. If you Israel will return, then return to me, declares the Lord. Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 1 through 4. If we as the church want a remedy, it is to turn back to God and away from detestable.
All right.
All the way from Virginia Beach, Virginia. The result is Evangelist Latina Tammy Price from the Rosemary Church of Christ.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. I'm full. That was enough for me right there. I love to hear the word. Amen. Amen. Praise God. I'm excited to be here. Thank you, Pastor Breon, for the invitation to this wonderful program, the Vision Program. Giving honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who's the head of my life. I give an honor to my pastor, Pastor Janetta Bird. I give an honor to Pastor Willard, the overseer of this lovely church. Amen. Everybody, members and friends, everybody. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and get right to it. Amen. We're getting late in the hour. I'm not long-winded, so I don't need 10. I probably just need 7. I'm going to go with the original plan, which was 7. Amen. I'm just going to say a quick prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, your word is already in this place. Your presence is already in this place, Lord. Speak through the lips of clay. Have your way. Let it go forth to accomplish what you send it out to do. And to you be all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I've been given the word remedy. Remedy. Amen. To cure, relieve, or heal. To restore to natural or proper condition. To put back right. To remedy a matter, to counteract or remove, to remedy an evil. I would like to speak on the word remedy from a sickness point of view. When we look at the current condition of our churches, we know that something is wrong. Church, as we once knew it, is not the same. Church 20, 30 years ago is no longer. For those of us who have spiritual eyes to see, we know that some sort of sickness or disease has infiltrated the body of Christ, which is the church. When sickness enters a body, we know that the body can no longer function. In many cases, the body becomes weak and unable to function to its full capacity or unable to be effective. Some may ask, what has happened to the church? How did we get here? It was once a place of refuge and strength, a place of healing and deliverance, a place of breakthrough and victory for God's people. What happened to the church? The church has allowed her walls to be breached. Now who? The world. The church took her eyes off Jesus and started looking at the world. Became enamored with the world and the things that the world doing, how the world doing it, and what the world got. And I want that. The church has took her eyes off Jesus. The need to be relevant to the world has cost us. We want to sound like the world. Oh my God, we want to look like the world and dress like the world. We want to be entertained by the world. When God told us in 2 Corinthians 6 and 17, come out from among them and be separated from the world and touch not the unclean things, and I will receive you. Why are we touching that which is unclean? Why we just gotta put our hands on that which is dirty, that which is filthy, that which is contaminated. When you touch unclean things, you leave yourself in a position to catch viruses, catch germs, catch infection. Now you need a cure. Now you need a remedy because you didn't got yourself sick. Because you just had to touch it. Now we need a cure. Now we need a remedy. The church has lost her discernment. We have compromised so much that we can't discern the real from the fake anymore. All because they can sing. Or they sang real good. Let them come on in here and sing. They'll pack the house. All because they have a gift. They can play that keyboard. They can play that keyboard. We need a keyboard player. That'll get people. People like music. That'll get them. All because he can hoop. Oh, he can hoop and he can tickle your ears, my God. He can hoop real good. Oh, my God. But well, he's doing all that hooping, but living like Satan's junior deputy. But that's okay, because he got a gift.
Yes. All right.
Because we lack discernment.
Yeah.
Or we're taking persons' gifts and we're calling it anointing.
Oh.
Corinthians 13:13. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. 1 Peter 4:7. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. What does sin produce? Death.
Yes.
Sickness, hatred, division. But if we got love, that's the remedy.
Yeah.
It covers all that sin. So today, church, thank God for his remedy. A remedy to heal what was sick. A remedy to make free what was bound. A remedy to resurrect what was dead.
Yes.
He said, upon this rock, I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The church shall live and not die to declare the words of the Lord. The church is going to go on, and God says, I'm coming back for a church without a spot or a wrinkle. When he comes back, how will he find his church? Will he find them loving? Will he find them doing the work of the Lord? Will he find them walking in truth? When he found him walking in obedience, how will he find his church when he returns? And I'm going to leave with this. Get right, church. Paul, Levant, Jones,
trying to come behind all this fire. Amen. Amen. Nothing but fire. Amen. I'm coming out of the text that was in the brochure. Amen. I'm coming out of the text. So put your finger right here at 1 Peter 4:16-19 while I get through. I'm going to need all my 10 minutes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Clarification. Clarification is the action of making a statement or situation less confused and more comprehensible. It is the discipline or skill of leading people to a correct or adequate understanding of any previous teaching, subject matter, given instructions, change of position, or state of being. Uh-huh. Now, here's my understanding of the question posed today by our facilitator. Is there inherently something wrong with the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ according to the Scriptures? Or does it appear to have problems or seem to be more of a problem than a solution for the world today? The good news, church, is that we can measure our own personal effectiveness or that of the institution we call the church in the face of real opposition when we understand this. God is working out our own individual worship so that when we come together as a corporate body to testify of his goodness, we are all the more committed and we are all the more powerful, which is what the world really needs to see. That's what the world needs to see. So I've come to celebrate the church, amen? To celebrate the faith of the church, for it is the victory that overcomes this world. And to call each of us to a place of personal accountability. Because for a lot of folks, it's almost scriptural to keep playing the blame game. Lord, it's that wife that you gave me. Or the devil made me do it. But 2 Chronicles 7:14 said, if my people are called by my name shall humble themselves first. We didn't come today to humble nobody else. You should have came today to humble yourself first. Then pray. I submit therefore today, church, that there's nothing wrong with the church per se, but the worship just ain't right. Let's go to the text. 1 Peter 4:16-19. It says, yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall be the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner be? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator. The first clarification is one of understanding what the question is today. And the second is of what type of judgment Peter is speaking of in the text and the type of life that the Christian is called by God to endure. He says, don't be ashamed, church, at the testing of your faith, beloved, as if something strange is happening to you. But he says to rejoice that you're actually still on the potter's wheel. God is not done with you. You have a holy opportunity to worship God in the midst of what everything that you're going through. Sometimes it's hard to see in the natural God's purpose and exactly what he's trying to do, because everything in our lives that come into us, we can't control it. Now, whoever told you that all you needed to do was accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and everything would be all right didn't tell you the whole truth. They didn't give you clarification. So don't let the enemy make you ashamed today that your life is not going the way you want it to go. Right? Don't blame leadership like they did in the wilderness, right? They blame Moses and they blame Aaron, because all you really need to do is have a one-on-one with God to resolve your worship issues. Don't make your journey harder than it has to be. When you're contending with the Lord, don't get mad at God because of what he's doing in your life. He's allowing certain things to happen to bring you through the wilderness. You don't know how to get out. He's the only one that can get you out. Look at the text. The text says that the key to living successfully, even though no one wants to suffer, is to glorify God along the way. And to commit your soul into the hands of a faithful creator. You might have a problem with the church, but God doesn't have a problem with his church. The third clarification, I'm on number three now, is our identity in Christ, because we're following way too many people that don't know God. Too many people that are bashing the church, making money off the church, profiting off the church, and they're not even born again.
The church is not an organization, but an organism that will suffer according to the will of God. It's in the text. But it's nonetheless victorious. And there will not be another Pentecost to birth a different church by some other Lord coming behind this church, which is already established and called by God the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth, the flock which Jesus has purchased with his own blood, according to Acts 20 and 28. The church belongs to God, and it is one with the Lord, united with him in spirit, as a husband is with his wife. The Bible says in Ephesians 5, 30-32, that this is a spiritual mystery. Once you're in the church, you're in for good. And you can't get away from the keeper who can't keep you as long as you want to be kept. The church is unique. It is called out from the darkness of this world. Just as the only begotten Son is holy and unique. Jesus said, you are now the light of the world. And the city on the hill cannot be hidden. Why are you trying to hide? We are ambassadors for God. We got to get out of these four walls. Permission to preach to all. Repentance for the remission of sins. And be reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. No other entity has this charge from God. And all that have come behind the church are pure counterfeits. The church is the spiritual extension of Jesus in the earth. His body. And it is the destiny of the church to be without spot, without wrinkle, without blemish, or any such thing. The church is going to be all right. It is still growing in the face of false gospels, in the face of false brethren, false Christs, resistance, and indifference from the inside, government bureaucracy, and satanic timetables from without. The church may seem anemic to some, but the purpose and the mandate of the church is almost complete. The Bible says that the fullness of the Gentiles have almost come in. Fourthly, I must clarify today that seasons of power are given to evil to oppress the truth, to oppress the church, so things may look worse than they actually are. I'm coming from a different perspective today. Amen. Peter wrote to a suffering church in our text, saying that it's judgment season for the house of God before it comes to the rest of the world. So guess what? Guess what, church? We need to get right. We need to be an example of what is to come. We ought to be working like Jesus says while it's day, because the night comes when no man can work. He's talking about a time where the world will hate us just because we wear the name of Christ. But we still must obey this gospel in hope. Even as we can actually see the hand of God removing, coming off of this land. Because of all of its sin and rebellion. Don't you see it? You don't see the hand of God moving off this land? The fifth clarification is of discernment and repentance. And this is necessary because the text says that the righteous are scarcely saved. A lot of people are rolling the dice. They still sitting on two sides of the fence. Don't waste time trying to figure out who's real and who's fake in the church if you're still shaking. But let the wheat and the tares grow up together. That's what Jesus says. And take a time where he will separate them. Get your focus right. Jesus gives clarification once again in the book of Revelation, chapters 2 and 3. And he says that their biggest issues were concerning their worship and how they were not properly responding to worldly outside pressures. He says, church, you have done this, and you have done that. And guess what? We're doing a lot of great things, church. We're doing a lot of good things, but are they God things? Jesus goes on and says, I have somewhat against you. I have something against you because you have what? You have left your first love. Where is the clarity of discernment when we can't recognize when the Lord has something against us?
All right.
You worried about Susie Q and Bobby Lou, but the Lord is looking at you kind of funny. He says that you're tolerating false doctrine. Doctrine of Balaam, the Nicolaitans, and Jezebel is running amok in your church. And your dedication to me is lukewarm at best. He goes on in Revelation 3 and 18 and says, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich. So much for the prosperity gospel. Jesus said, you ain't rich. White raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness does not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that they may, that thou may actually see. The church got an eye problem. Yeah, yeah. We gotta have a platform service to realize that we should be looking up instead of looking at each other. I hope you didn't come here today to think that I'd be talking about somebody. Verse 19, Jesus says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. That's the word for the church today. It's his word that actually gives us clarification of where we actually stand with him at any given moment.
Yeah.
You are the church, and you can't just ask
what's wrong with the church without asking what's wrong with yourself. When the worship ain't right, it affects the whole body, even from on the other side of the globe.
Yes.
Because God made us family just like that.
Amen.
Members of one another. Yes. If you don't believe me, just read the story of Achan.
Yes, he was aching at the end.
Finally, Jesus gave clarification of his mission, his person, and doctrine so that there would be no misunderstanding his will. He was the suffering servant of Isaiah 53. So he knows personally about what he's asking each of us to endure concerning suffering.
Yeah.
He said, if you would have known me, then you would have known my Father. I have not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. I am the way, the truth, and the life.
No,
you need some more clarification than that? No man comes unto the Father except by me. He told the Jews that before Abraham was, I am. And the Bible says that they took up stones to stone him, because they said that he made himself out to be God, and he was. If you don't know who he is, then guess what? You don't know who you are. And you definitely don't know where you're going. Do you know where you're going to?
Look,
I like the way Jesus taught.
Amen.
He gave clarification. He said, you have heard it said before, but now I tell you this. You heard it said to hate your enemies, but I tell you to love your enemies and to pray for them that despitefully use you. Isaiah warned of all these people up in the church talking about they worshiping the Messiah, but it was only with their lips and their hearts were far from him. Jesus said, in vain do they worship me, teaching doctrines of men as commandments. Listen to what Paul said. Paul says, I marvel at you, church, that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another gospel, but there be some people here that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ.
Yes.
Listen, the church is filled with gospel perverts who have despised the grace of God, twisting the word of God, adding to the word of God, changing it up. One day you receive Jesus as Savior, and now that ain't good enough. Now you need him as Lord. But now you still ain't saved. Now you gotta have him as Master. What's next? We have allowed so much foundational teaching to be chipped away and have neglected to strengthen those things that remain that truly identify us and keep us in fellowship with the head of the church. When we work out our own soul salvation with fear and trembling, we can strengthen our strengths and weaken our weaknesses and bring nations to obedience to the faith and reach them that obey not the gospel before it's too late.
All right.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let's go to prayer. I just want to pray about a few things. Clarification.
Yes.
The clarification that we got, isn't it refreshing to know that our clarification is upon his cup, he will heal his church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. Can't get no more clarity than that. I don't care what the church go through. He said the gates of hell will not prevail on the church. Clarification. That was refreshing, Deacon. In the midst of all we're going through, all these things that were said, it's true. But the beauty of it is,
that we get is that upon this rock,
yes.
Come on,
back.
Yes. Victory.
Makes your hair
warm. That's it. Come on, you. All that stuff is going on in the body.
Yeah.
But upon this rock, you better say it, boy. And when they were alone, he expounded all things to his disciples.
Yes.
Amen.
Mark chapter 4, verse 34. If we want to do better as a church, we have to ask Jesus questions regularly for clarity, like the disciples. This means we are on good soil. Mark chapter 4, verse 8.
Yes.
Who choose to hear and understand Jesus' message, and who have been chosen to continue Jesus' work. Explanation.
Praise God. Amen.
All the way from Petersburg to Richmond.
Petersburg,
Virginia. All the way of 3rd Foundation, 32 Ministry.
All right.
Pastor Anthony Orlando.
Orlando. I'm done. Let's go to work.
Amen.
The question that Pastor Breon asked was, what's the reason for or answers to the church problems? Y'all got to hear me very clearly. You are confused as to who this book belongs to. The book does not belong to the world because they can't discern it.
Right.
It already says that it is foolishness to those who are perishing.
All right.
So the next problem that we have, and my brother has presented this to me for years, and I had to ask myself, God, who are you talking to? Because the Bible says that the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Now, the word knows nothing about the heart as it concerns God, because they have not given their heart over to him.
Come on.
So who is he talking to?
All right. Jesus.
My mini sermon title today is called If. If. If in the Bible implies contingencies, which means the issue has not been settled at this time. What is the reason for the church's problems? It's very simple. It's not sin, it's unbelief. Again, we're not talking about the world because they haven't entered in.
Right. All right.
Amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever did what?
Believe.
Shall not perish.
Come on.
Amen.
We're suffering from unbelief. But what is it that the church does not believe? The church doesn't believe the truth. It doesn't believe the truth of the word. The reason the church is crippled, hear me again, the world doesn't talk about the Bible, and neither do we. We talk about God of the Bible, but we never talk about the Bible of God. So there is no point of reference to this truth that we proclaim, we so readily believe. How can you believe what you don't read and can't understand? You're suffering from unbelief. Not the world, the church.
Amen.
They do not believe. Christ even said to his disciples, we've been rolling together all this time.
Come on,
you still don't believe. You don't believe.
Come on now. Talk to the church.
How do we know the church does not believe? 1 John 2:3-6. We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments.
Yes.
Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands, right, is a liar.
Amen.
So he's not talking to the world. We're supposed to know him.
Amen.
He's a liar.
Amen.
And the truth is not in that person.
All right.
But if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them.
Yes.
This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. Not talking about the word.
Come on, man.
Hebrews 6:4-6. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the word to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them. To renew them again unto repentance.
Yes.
Even Paul said, I was perishing because of ignorance and unbelief. Someone said earlier, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. And so the issue is very, very, very simple. And the remedy is very clear. There's a choice that must be made today. And I'm not talking about the unbeliever. The unbeliever is our job after we get right and become believers. This sermon is not for the unbeliever.
Come on. Amen.
And see, why did Paul get upset and say, by now, you all should be eating meat, but you still drinking juicy juices. Even in food. What did he say? You can't handle the truth.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Joshua 24:15 says, and if it seems evil unto you, who's he talking to? Because here's how we know he's talking to us. If it seems evil unto you to serve, how would an unbeliever know how to serve?
That's right.
If it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell.
Yes.
But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It's a shame when we have to spend our time talking to the body of Christ about repentance. See, our job title has changed because of the unbelief in the house. Why am I spending all of my days at night talking to believers to get them to believe.
When I get wounded and I'm riding in my car, it's not the unbeliever I'm dealing with. It's the believer that does not believe. I spend my days, I will not pray for you if you're a believer, because you're supposed to know what I know. Yes. Why is it that you never call me to pray for me?
Yes.
The Bible says, do not cast your pearls before swine. Right. But it's the people in the house of God that are doing all the oinking, and they're holding me up from the unsaved folks that I'm trying to get.
Repent. And then we have this second group. And again, we're talking about believers.
They come and call you and tell you that they know they're not right. But then they want to hear you tell them for 30 minutes why they should get right, and they still don't get right. My wife and I have one statement now for those that will not recommit. If Tony Mack has given you a loaf of bread and you didn't eat, I'm not going to give you a slice now. I'm not going to give it to you. You need to recommit. You need to get on your knees and say, Father, I've been MIA. I've been missing in action. I'm sorry. I lost my soul. Reconcile your walk. Repent.
Yes, Lord.
Recommit and reconcile. Right. And that's what we're dealing with.
Amen.
When I go to heaven, I thought I was going to be talking about like the guys I went to school with and they not saved, or somebody I met at the job. All I do my days is deal with people in the church, and I'm tired of them. He said, work out whose salvation? Your own. With fear and trembling. Yeah. But you got me scared and trembling because I'm tired of talking to you.
Woo!
Yes.
How do you know
Jesus?
The question has been answered in your walk? And this is what I wrote. How will you know when you the real deal?
Yes.
Every part of the truth and will of God should be set before all who profess the gospel and be urged on their hearts and consciences. What does that mean? My brother, I use this line that I use it all the time. My brother, Brian Leonard, says, loving God means spending time with God.
That's right.
Spending time with God means spending time in His Word.
Amen.
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 And see,
Jesus.
You know rapper's delight, but you don't know the Word.
Yeah.
All the way through.
Come on, man.
And then you tell me, well, Pastor Matt, everybody have a memory, you know. Come on. All of us have things in the Word we struggle with that doesn't make it not true.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
How will you know? How will you and others know that you have not only answered the question, but overcome the problem? There are two ways. You shall know them by their fruit. It's hard to get a fruit juice in the body right now because it's a lot of rotten fruit. I'd rather go to Walmart and get me a smoothie. Of course, I'm dealing with.
Come on,
dude. That's good.
Explanation.
And then it's this simple. Here is the final explanation. If you believe in me, as the scripture has said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. So, why is your family not drinking
Why is your wife not drinking? Why is your husband not drinking? Where is the living water? Because unbelief kills the well. There's no water coming from the well because there's no belief. Give me these 20 Navy SEALs over 2,000 buck privates anyway, and I'll go take the kingdom. The Bible says the kingdom suffers violence, and the violence take it by force. We don't even have a water canteen on the battlefield because we do not believe. And so, I pose to us today, in the closing of our explanation, all of us are called to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. But how can you go if you do not believe? I love you.
We have to get back to believe. Believing in God. Our biggest battles is with the believers.
My God.
Jesus, help
us. Come on.
Thank God. You don't do this. You ain't doing that. That ain't right. This ain't right. Biggest battle is with believers in the house of God.
My God.
That's that explanation.
Jesus.
We got to get it right.
Yes.
Inside.
Yep. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, heavens. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. Didn't you have a wonderful time here today? We are better for it.
Yes.
When we need these doors.
Yes.
My goodness. Each one of you has something that we can eat for the rest of our
lives.
I knew he was going to do it. Pastor, I'm going to give out these bags. If you have anything you need to say,
Amen.
Greet Bishop Antonio Willis, the angel of this house, in the name of Jesus.
I said, you see, if you see my head weeble wobbling, because I've already popped me a Prozac. I'm healed in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I've got my remedy. I got my size. Now this was rich.
Amen.
What I do, this is what I love. I love to hear good teaching, good preaching. This is it.
Amen.
So hopefully everybody will go away from here with something today that may have jumped out at them.
Amen.
Whether it was the solution, the quick fix, whether it was the result, the key, the remedy, the clarification, the explanation, maybe something was said that may have just jumped out at you.
Amen.
You can work on you.
Amen.
That's what it's all about.
Amen.
At the end of the day, we all in here are believers. We love God. And we have to just return to our first love.
Amen.
That's
right.
There's nothing else to it.
Right.
As Deacon spoke about clarification, and he clarified some things. The church is in good shape. It just doesn't look like it.
Yes.
Ah, that's because Satan always masquerades as an angel of light.
Mm-hmm.
So he makes it look distorted.
Mm-hmm.
He makes it look discouraged, and he makes it look depressing.
Mm-hmm.
That's why people aren't coming.
Mm-hmm.
Because he makes it look like that. But as the ecclesia,
Amen.
As the ecclesiastic,
yes.
We have to let our light so shine. Yes, we have to be that salt. Mm-hmm. And then God will do the rest. We'll leave the results up to Him. Mm-hmm. All we have to be is, as Pastor Matt just shared with us, see, the explanation is we got to believe. Do we really believe?
That's right. That's
the question. And what we read and what we say and whom we believe in.
Yes.
Amen.
You know, regardless of our suffering or our tragedies or our downfalls or shortcomings or storms, do we really believe Him in those times?
Right.
Yes. And we must do, because we're here.
Yeah, right.
All of us look really good. Amen. Even though some of us have medical issues. Some of us have sickness in our bodies and things of that nature, but we press.
Right.
We press. Doesn't make us look sick. We may be physically sick, but we press.
That's right. Amen.
He keeps us looking anointed.
Yes.
That's what gives us our youth. And so today, this is wonderful.
Yes.
Rich. All I can say is that it was rich.
Yes.
It was fruitful.
Yes. Amen.
And I hope everybody leaves from here with some food.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank God for Pastor putting this on and having the heart to want to just have people to exercise their gifts and just to come out in the body of Christ. We had a lot of folks up in here. Some folk had to leave because they had funerals, they had other engagements. They wanted you to know they were truly, they were touched.
Amen.
That's what he told me today. So, you know, it's outstanding God. And just in case somebody came in here and I had an outstanding God.
Praise the Lord. Give a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Angel of this house. Wonderful man of God. Love it. Amen. I thank God for each and every one of you. We can thank you for this time. Hallelujah. Make sure you guys don't lose nothing in that bag. In the bag. Make sure you don't lose. Don't lose the cards in that bag.
I hold everybody's bag.
Amen. Let us bow. Father God, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for what you have done in this place today, God. You use your vessels, God, to hurl your word, Lord. Oh, God, and they came from a divine place, God, with that word, God.
Yes.
They have us to look at ourselves, God, and have us to see things like how you see them, God, through the eyes of Christ, God. So we thank you for them, Lord, and they're laying before you, God, that you would minister to their hearts, Lord. Oh, God, we thank you, Lord, for the word that was given to nourish us, God, and refresh us, God. We are refreshed today, God.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
You have refreshed us in this place, God. And we're going to take this wherever we go, God, today, God. Now unto Him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the throne of grace with majesty and honor and dominion in His name forevermore. Let the church say amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.